When did you start on this Scottish journey?
Let me take you back. I started at the end of 2006. I would say my official start wasn't until December of 2006, but my unofficial start was when I was helping wrangle the first research trip to Scotland for this crew, the story artist and the director, back in August of 2006. And we did the trip in August because we wanted to time it to a Highland Games that were happening in Scotland at the time, the Lonnick Games and the Highland the Hellenic and the Braemar Gathering were both important games that we were studying as part of the research. And so we went time to that in August and have been on ever since.
So how long was the conversation they were having before that?
Oh, that was a good year and a half before that, because you pitch, our filmmaker is a filmmaker-driven studio and all the ideas come from the directors. And so filmmaker Brenda Chapman had pitched her idea I think late 2004, just the seed of the idea. She was working on Cars at the time, and she was thinking about her relationship with her six-year-old daughter. And her daughter, Emma, was sort of feisty and spirited and opinionated, and they were really butting heads. Mm-hmm. And Brenda thought, wow, what's she going to be like as a teenager? and there felt like there was a story in that for Brenda, and she shared that with John Lasseter, and he was like, yes. And you know, particularly the idea of doing sort of a sincere folktale and setting it in this magical and mystical Scotland, that this impetuous teenager really wants to change her mom very much because nobody understands me. If only my life were different, can't you be
the
more
first teenager to feel that way?
Yeah, the first teenager able to feel that way. And so even the idea of changing to a bear, that started to gel in that first year and a half or so of development. Before any director is assigned a producer, they first have to work the idea in development for a while.
So were you a Pixarite for eons before that, or?
I am an 18-year Pixar veteran. I worked on Toy Story.
So you were like 12 when you started.
Before you were probably even born. I came in 1994 for the last year of Toy Story for what was meant to be a one-year kind of gig, because there was no Disney deal. It was just like, we're making Toy Story. It'll probably be a flop. You have 1 year of employment. Enjoy it. And I'm like, okay, I'll take it. I'm happy to work here.
So were you from up there, or were you?
I was from up there, but I'd been at UCLA Film School, and so I'd been in LA for 6 years for undergrad and grad school, and I wanted to work in the Bay Area for my one job I was going to have. And so I applied, and I got in for Toy Story. But at the end of that year, I was intending to go back to film school and maybe then get that PhD and be a great professor and all those things. Huh. And then, who knew? Toy Story worked out pretty well. And so the deal with Disney became a 5-picture deal, and I was retained to work on the rest of them.
So was animation a particular love of yours, or was that?
It was not. In fact, animation, this is the deep dark secret very few people know. I did not have a thing for animation at all. I always liked it okay. I liked cartoons, but I never went out of my way for them. What attracted me to Pixar was actually that the merge of art and technology. So I was less interested in the animation of it, more interested in the science of it at the time. I wanted to bring these sort of fine artists together with these very, very, you know, engineering, science-y, computer-y types who spoke completely different language. And the left brain, right brain mashup has always been very interesting to me as someone who has that split brain where I don't quite fit in either space. And Pixar was this community of misfits who were just like that. And I was like, oh, I found my home. And then I think my love for animation grew from there, but maybe not the way other people love animation. Right. The storytelling possibilities and all the things you can do, great, but I think the reason I came to love animation was the way you can invent and control really everything. I mean, yes, there's no control in filmmaking, but there's this feeling of constantly like, I've lost control of this production. But in the moment, every pixel is, you know, under our control, and that appealed to my organizational sense.
It doesn't sound like you were overwhelmingly obsessed with being a producer at that point either.
No, I was mostly obsessed with getting my feet wet in trying to learn as much as I could. I didn't actually truly know what a producer did at the time. I had inklings of it, and I was watching the producers work, and it looked like a good job. It just looked really hard. So I'm like, oh, that's really hard. I'm going to keep working on my spreadsheet.
So you were on the money side when you started?
I wasn't the money side. I was a scheduling coordinator. So I started actually by tracking the footage and the frames, really trying to help organize everything that had to get done for the last year of Toy Story. And every department had quotas. Animation has to do this many shots a week or else they won't finish, and this many feet of film a week. And so I tracked all that and made charts and graphs. But I did everything. I took people's photos, Polaroid photos for the employee photo board, and I organized the company lunches, and just really jack of all trades, you know. We didn't really have a team of production assistants. You know, there was just a few of us, and I was one of the coordinators. And Jonas Rivera, who became the producer of Up, later, he and I started within a couple of weeks of each other and kind of were just doing everything that was needed.
So was there a point for you personally where things changed, where it felt like the switch flipped?
And yes, there was. It was, I worked, after a Toy Story, I worked on some commercials. We had a shorts division then that made commercials. So I worked on, you know, some really fun and funny commercials. So I learned a lot about the pipeline, how you have to get things from early layout all the way through animation and lighting. I kind of got the whole picture of it on a short form. But then I asked if I could be a manager of one of the departments on Bug's Life. And, you know, the producer sort of looked at me and said, what do you know about management? And I was like, well, I was an RA in college. Isn't that the same thing? She's like, it's not the same thing. But anyway, they took a chance on me. And it was actually in a lot of ways like being an RA, but just...
That's the feeling I got.
It is. I was like, wow, I can do that. But no, it was quite difficult, but I learned so much. And I think that's when the switch flipped for me, when I was managing the art department of Bug's Life. Production designers, art directors, and sketch artists all together, you know, sculpting in clay and pastel and paint and doing all this fine art that was then going to become blueprints for the technical teams. So the dialogues that I learned to have, the dialogue I learned to have with the technical departments and their management as we're trying to translate all this stuff into computer imagery and make a great story out of it, that was where I was kind of like on fire with the possibilities of that. I was like, you know, and then it became like, okay, I get what this is. And I started watching much more closely what the producers did and starting to learn and just learn from Darla Anderson, who is the producer of A Bug's Life. I'm like, this is something I could get behind. This is very interesting. And it's very gratifying because if you're helping harness the creative energy of people who really need to focus on creative, you don't want them focusing on the deadline. You want them focusing on the work. You want to help make sure the deadline happens, you know, without hindering them. And that was something, once I, you know, learned that that was a strength, I was like, I want to use this part of myself.
So what do you, when you started in, what year did you say?
2006. 94.
No, when you started in this movie.
Oh, yeah, 2006.
2006, you came on. So what, did you come on with a title producer? Was that your...
I did. I came on the title, but yeah, I was in development as one of the development general sort of producers. I was helping a few films along at the time. Every director kind of is just getting their first storyboards going. And so, you know, kind of helping a few different directors get off the ground. And then the one that was ready to go next was Brenda's film. And so then she and I were matched up as a director producer and sent off to, you know, actually we sent off to Scotland first, then we came back and then we were matched up. But I was called producer at the time.
So you knew all the pieces of that early part of the puzzle that you'd have to do, which meant going and doing the research and all that kind of stuff. How involved are you with really shaping the story at that point? Or
at that early point, I was not involved in shaping the story so much as making sure we had a team to shape the story. I made sure we got enough storyboard artists, editors to start putting a story together. Once we had built the story and looked at it as a movie, all just in storyboard form, a 90-minute, like, here's the movie, all storyboarded, then I was able to, you know, weigh in creatively on, like, wow, that really worked. I love this. Or, ooh, yeah, it all worked except for this part right here, this part right here. And then we just start kind of workshopping it over the years. And we put it together as a movie about every 3 or 4 months for the whole time we're making it. And so 3 or 4 times a year we're staring at this thing as a movie and then tearing it down and putting it back together and tearing it down and putting it back together.
And are you presenting that to a lot of people or to just a short core group?
I like to present it to a lot of people. I mean, we actually talk about it after we screen it. We talk to a small group of our, what we creative brain trust. We call Andrew Stanton, Pete Docter, John Lasseter, our executive producers, and some of the directors of the other films at Pixar. So we discuss it with them and we talk about how it could be better, where it could be better. But we show it, I like to show it to an audience every time. So every time we screen it, before going to that notes session, I like to fill the theater because you can't get a feel for a movie, really, to me, without an audience. You know, watching a movie alone in a big empty theater, it can be fine, you know, but I think when you really want to feel if something's working, are the laughs hitting? Are people, you know, is the emotion hitting? Is the energy hitting? When are people getting bored? When are they glazing over? You need to watch the audience. So I always fill the theater and I look at people as they're watching.
And your team is a good audience, the Pixar team family.
They are, but I had to keep mixing it up to get fresh eyes because I, you know, I only had, when we started, I only had about 40 people on the crew. That's not enough to fill the theater. So I would invite the teams from other films. I would invite, let's say, the crew from Up or Toy Story 3, other films that were in production at the time. Hey, can you come watch our movie with us? Fill up the theater. And then as my crew grew, I was able to fill up the theater just with brave people.
So they did the same thing with you guys?
Yeah, we get invited to others. Yeah, we go. We just were invited to see Monsters University recently, and we're looking at the reels for the Good Dinosaur, which comes out in 2014.
So this movie went through a bit of a transition, I guess.
Yes, a bit.
a bit. I mean,
we had several different transitions of story, and we had a director change, and we had release date changes as well, because Disney did not own Pixar when we started this film, so that changed our release slate as well.
So that's a fairly significant thing to change directors and go through that process.
You know, it is, and yet it is also something Pixar does and other studios do fairly often. So significant, yes. Uncommon, no. Industry-wide, films change directors quite a bit. Animated films also quite a bit. At Pixar, we've done it several times. Ratatouille, actually, Mark Andrews, who's the director of Brave, he came on with Brad Bird to Ratatouille and as head of story when Brad joined that project. Sort of late in the game, Cars 2 had a director change, Brave had a director change, and Toy Story 2, way back then, that had a director change.
So
but
what
we
kind
do
of,
this.
What kind of thing happens that makes you feel like, it's just that you need another voice? Is it, like
it
a rewrite?
Be, it can be many things. I think every film is a slightly different situation. Sometimes you just want, you know, fresh energy. Sometimes you want more of a certain thing, less of a certain thing. But the way we change sequences during the film, like we have some sequences, scenes in the film we really, really love, but they don't serve the story and we have to get rid of them, and that's painful. But we do that from the very beginning. We take out whole sequences, we get rid of characters, we add new characters. It's just so, so fluid the whole time. And honestly, the direction of it, it's, you know, one of the most important components, but it's also something that we have to be willing to let go of if it's not getting the movie to where it needs to be. And we were 18 months out at the time that Mark came onto the film. And that's really where you just need to have a certain amount of the story at a certain point, and creative differences were apparent, and so Mark came in to really build on what Brenda had done, but the core of that story, the origin of it, the characters, the world, those were all quite developed, and so you know, Mark's thought through.
So first to third act is pretty much the same story, or
you
similar
know,
kind
think
of story?
The whole thing is kind of the same story, but it's told in, I mean, we always had this, you know, from the very earliest pitch, you know, the basic structure was in place, and that has remained the same throughout.
So were you guys even thinking
about Bear and all these things in the resolution?
Were you guys even thinking about girl power and that kind of, I mean, because that was how it was pitched,
you know,
early on
years ago. We were never thinking about girl power as like, this is going to be the girl power movie. We certainly, you know, a lot has been said about this being, you know, our first girl-centered movie, that we've never had a female character driving the story forward and, you know, making the mistakes and solving the problems and, you know, really being
driving. But also being like a female producer, female director.
Driving force, like the girl power thing. But we couldn't, kind of couldn't be a slave to it either. I mean, I think when you start making a film like this, like any film, you can't be a slave to the conventions of a genre or the stereotypes of a character. And if we set out, it's like, this is going to be the movie with the girl in it. So then you get all these ideas of like, well, what do girls do? And what would girls want to see? And blah, blah, blah. You get stuck. And it's no way, you can't tell a story that way. I don't think you can tell a good one. You have to really build character the way we would build character in any Pixar movie. So that means like heroic journey, you know, breakdown of relationship, breakdown of communication, healing, blah, blah. This is the arc. And so we treated it without gender, really. We had to make the story work. And then, and in terms of, you know, the gender of the director and producer and everything, like we had a lot of senior talent on the film who were and have been and have remained and are still female. But
they didn't turn into bears or
no, we didn't turn everybody on the bears, but you know, some of our, you know, department supervisors and senior animators, you know, female. So there are a lot of women on the crew, but there are still very few women in the sort of the story ranks in the industry wide. You know, I think it's starting to change, but there are still more men than women in those roles, and therefore I think feeding into those leadership positions, fewer women than men really still coming into it.
The one of the things that's interesting about the movie is that it doesn't feel like a feminist agenda, which would be the extreme version, or even a, you know, it doesn't feel like a girl power movie. It is a girl who's having power. It's her mother who's exhibiting a lot of power, but it doesn't feel like, it feels like it's just a story and it happens to be a girl. It happens to, you know.
Well, I'm glad you caught that, because that was deliberate. We didn't want to create something that we and our daughters or ourselves or our mothers were going to not want to watch. And so these are, I think we have great admiration for the classic Disney fairy tales and princess movies and things like that, but we really set out to do something different, which was a Pixar hero. And we had to treat it like a Pixar hero. Like, if she happened to be female, great. And now we can say we're proud to bring this, you know, kick butt female to the screen, but it couldn't be the intention of like, we're going to blaze a new trail for girls everywhere. It's like, you can't make a movie that way. It's just, you're going to just start breaking rules to be breaking them, you know, and that's not the right motivation.
Well, my final college paper, I think, when I graduated was about how Disney was misogynist. And if you look at those old movies, the women, the hero women, were always, like, their faces were less developed than the bad girls, and all he was really interested in was the evil women. He wasn't really, had no interest in the strong front women at all.
I think many of us have written those papers. I think I did mine on, like, the blonde versus the brunette, and why is the brunette always the villainess, so kind of thing. And I think we all wrote our feminist theory papers and had a good time with it. But it was refreshing for us to be able to bring out this film that is just more relatable to us, I think, in terms of the teenager I was. Mm-hmm. I wasn't concerned about getting married. I was more worried about how my basketball team was going to do in the big tournament, or, you know, how I was going to do on my choir or my mm-hmm. term papers. Like, you know, we have other things going on in our lives, you know, and what girl today is completely defined by being a girl and wanting to get married in the teenage years.
It's also one of the interesting things about the picture that at the end, it's not defined either. Whereas in most of these pictures, you would expect that to be the happy ending, is that, right. you know, the fourth guy turns out to be Prince Charming, and,
right.
you know, she really wants to be with him, and,
right.
but she's not saved by anybody but herself.
No, she had to save herself, because that's coming of age. You know, you don't come of age because somebody married you or somebody, you know, saved you. You come of age because you had to reckon with yourself, and you had to find your bravery, and you had to find your resolve, and you had to learn what you're capable of. That's how you come of age, I think. I think that's what Merida has to do, which means at the end, the love story is there, but it's love of family and acceptance and like, okay, you know, I can be this person and fit in this world just in a different way. And my mom can be, in a lot of ways, the person I want her to be, and I can love her as she is. These are things that she had to come to on her own. It was very important to us that she resolve things herself and that she find that love in her heart herself.
So one of the things, in talking to directors of these movies over the years, I'm not sure we've actually talked to a producer, who, except for maybe John, who is both.
Yeah, he's both.
But,
he's all things.
he's all things to all people. But, mm-hmm. You know, there's always that, there's been repeated conversation about feeling like things are moving forward, but you really don't know what you have until the sprint at the end, and it's completely freaky. Yeah. Is that true for the producer as well?
Yes. I mean, things are always moving forward, but I like the term forward in all directions, because they're not always moving all in one direction. It's mm-hmm. like, you're always moving on this movie, but you're not always making, I mean, it's never the same river twice. Every day the movie's slightly different. You're always changing it. And then right around the last maybe 12 weeks of production, it's like, we're as creatively locked as we think we're gonna be. Go, 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 go. But, you know, mm-hmm. and the last 6 months in particular are that. You really think you've got it, but you're still throwing out shots and adding shots, and you're doing trims. And even at Skywalker Ranch, when we were doing our final sound mix, that's mm-hmm. the final movie, we changed the shot then. We changed because we're like, hey, yeah, this could be funnier. What if we had the horse do blah, blah, blah? Like, really, you guys? Really? And yes, really. So you have to sort of embrace the madness of it all.
So are you there to say no, or are you there to say, this is how we're going to do it?
I'm the producer. I'm there to say, how quickly can we call the animators up to Skywalker Ranch so they can get briefed so that we can turn this around quickly? Mm-hmm. I rarely say no. Don't tell anybody. Oh, God. Yeah, I rarely say no, because it's going to be, you know, if I can be convinced, and Mark's really good at convincing me about what will make the movie better and what won't. You know, he describes mm-hmm. it. My first question is always, do you have to have it? And he'll always say not only that he has to have it, he'll say why. And once he explains why, it's really compelling. I want to make mm-hmm. it happen for him. And if he says why and it's, you know, not a reason I buy, then we'll kind of argue about it for a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then I'll say, you know, why don't we fix this other thing instead that's really easy to fix? And he's like, yeah, that'll do the same thing. As long as it achieves what it needs to achieve story-wise. Mm-hmm. And here, the particular fix at Skywalker, he was not able to achieve what he wanted story-wise without changing the animation. Mm-hmm. Once he explained why, I was like, fair enough. How fast can we do it? Can we do it in time? And so my job mm-hmm. is to get everybody on board with doing it quickly so we can get it in before.
So do you think this is a Pixar energy, or that, I mean, because it does seem like each of the companies that now is making movies is kind of its own little universe. And as much success as Pixar has had, each of them has had, you know, that each of these companies is coming from somebody with a very strong leadership position and mm-hmm. and the creation of a family somewhere. Do mm-hmm. you think that just is endemic to animation in general?
There is something, I think it takes a certain kind of person to be attracted to the animation business, right? Because, mm-hmm. but you're working, first of all, all filmmaking is collaborative. Animation is, you know, collaborative in slow motion, right? Because you're going for, instead of a nine, you know, a long live action shoot is what, 9 months or something like that? Mm-hmm. More likely principal photography is like, maybe it's a 3 month shoot and you've got post. You know, animation, the computer animated films at Pixar, the shortest one takes four years, right? You know, mm-hmm. I don't think we've ever done one in fewer than 4 years. The long ones can take 6 or 7, and you're in this for the long haul, and it does attract a person who wants to be part of a community. Mm-hmm. So there's the collaborative spirit of let's work together, and then there's the community of like, we're family now. And from the first research trip, I felt like, oh, I've got a family, whether I like it or not. And if you're gonna make a movie about a family, how better to do it than with a family where they've got your back? Mm-hmm. I mean, I did a lot of living, a lot of us did over the course of these movies. We have, you know, our kids are born, you know, we get married, you know, our parents start, you know, getting sick or, mm-hmm. or passing away. Things, you know, our lives change out from under us while we're doing this. And there's this home base that's very grounding. Even when we travel for work and the recording sessions and stuff, there's always this home base of like this Pixar community where you can look around. You know, have you ever been to the studio?
It's once.
The way it's built. I mean, mm-hmm. Steve Jobs was very hands-on in the design of this building, and he wanted it to be a creative place, the most creative place that he could make. Mm-hmm. And that meant that even the conference rooms have glass windows that you can look through. So there's the hominess of like, I'm coming, if no matter when I come to work, even if I'm in a conference room, in a meeting with somebody, I can look across and see a friend, a colleague, you know, across the atrium in another conference room. That it's like there's this, we're all in this together thing that's mm-hmm. even in the building's spirit, the center atrium, all these things are designed around collaboration and kind of like bringing a family together at the central table.
And you guys kind of started the production baby.
Yeah, well, that began with Toy Story. Yeah, the first movie to do it was Toy Story, I believe.
What you don't have in this picture is the concept art at the back of the movie. I think for the first time in a long time.
Yeah.
Was there a reason why, particularly?
Well, we have Steve Pilcher and his team are remarkably prolific. We have a lot of beautiful concept art, and it's all in a lot of it's in the Art of Brave book. But mm-hmm. For these credits, we really wanted to evoke a mood. Rather than specific scenes. You know, I think we didn't want to take you back to a moment in the movie. We wanted you to feel a certain way, mm-hmm. Particularly because of the build to what was very important to us was our Steve Jobs tribute. Mm-hmm. That's really the only thing from the movie in there, which is there's that wisp, because it was important to us that we have a feeling at the end of the movie and with the song and everything too, rather than a specific, mm-hmm. you know, moment or piece of art that would take you to a certain place.
Is there a point where you figured that out, where that came to you guys and you said?
About the credits?
Yeah.
It was Steve Pilcher came at it specifically from about feeling and design. So it was really in our art room one day, kind of just talking about what do we want for those end credits? And he just pitched it. And I think he wanted, yes, to do something a little different and also to keep our audience in this space, you know, not to really, I think he wanted no distraction from the feeling at the end of the movie. He just felt a lot for it.
So after 6 years and a baby and this whole thing that you created, does it feel like you're at the end of a journey that you're happy to be at the end at, or you're ready for the next journey, or does
Would
it feel
you
like?
Believe I am at the end of a journey that I'm very sad to be at the end at, and because it's that family thing. I'm a sucker for that community thing. I mean, I was the one who in the high school musical productions where I never wanted to go, I never wanted the shows to end and the cast wrap party afterward. I was always like, I'm gonna miss you guys. She's like, well, see you at school tomorrow. I'm like, it's not the same. I just love working with a team of artists and scientists and doing this. And I'm very, as happy as I am that Brave is done, I'm so bummed I won't get to work with this team every day. You know, we talk about, oh, we'll get the band together, we'll do it again, we'll all work on different projects. But, you know, there's lightning in a bottle. Each one of these films, that you hit this moment where you're just really in it together and you have each other's backs. You've developed a language together, particularly over a long haul of this many years where you started roughing it through the highlands together and you finish, you know, at a cool like Hollywood premiere, like, wow, you know, this is my family. We did this together, and I get very, it's a bit bittersweet.
You going to Edinburgh?
Yes.
That'll really do the circle.
Edinburgh, here we are again, yeah, full circle.
So, do they make you go to Hawaii for a month and pretend you're not working?
They
so
don't make me do that. Shoot, no, I am going to take my maternity leave because I haven't taken that yet, and I'm going to take some time off. Mark and I are both going to spend some time with our families.
But I mean, is that normal? Is that the kind of like you have to regain some sort of?
You definitely want to kind of clear your head a little bit. There's a lot goes into this. It's emotional energy, it's physical energy, it's everything. So we definitely need a little rest before starting up again.
And what will be the thing that starts you up again? Will it be a particular project or?
I actually don't yet know what I'm going to be. We're going to go into development and start working on more stories and hoping to connect with a great team and just get something going again.
So you'll likely develop something that's, be part of developing something that's not already in the pipeline.
Because those have already, everything that's in the announced pipeline has already been started, so I'm too late for those. But I will hope that I get to work on the Hawaiian research trip.
A lot of Hawaiian
project.
Trips.
Yeah. Let me see.
Well, they should have a Hawaiian, I think you guys could have a Hawaiian trip every year.
I think we should.
or at least go to Disney or something.
You should be Disneyland. Running the studio, yeah.
Well, you know.